Hi, good evening, everyone. Thanks for coming out on a Thursday evening. My name is Regina Gage, and I am the current president of the Democratic Women of Monterey County. Unless, I don't know, the 25th Amendment is invoked or something. They consider me to be unfit for my position. I ask them every time, but I'm still here. So anyway, welcome. Thank you again for coming. This is our last evening event for the year. We've been trying to do outreach as the Democratic Women, and we've had two evening panels, so this is our last evening panel for the year. So again, thanks for coming out on a Thursday night. I know some folks are still looking for parking, and I know parking's a little challenging, so hopefully they'll be straggling in, but I think we should get started because we want to hear from our panelists, and not me, of course. So let me introduce our moderator, and then I will turn it over to Claudia Melendez Salinas, and then she will introduce herself, of course, and introduce our panelists. So again, thank you. We'll have the conversation from 7 until 8 p.m., and then from 8 until 8:30, I believe, we'll take questions. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for being here. My name is Claudia Melendez Salinas. I'm a reporter for the Monterey Herald. I'm also an author. Yes, I wrote a book. And I'm here. I was invited to moderate this panel because I've been covering, among all the topics I've covered, I cover immigration. In fact, I went to USC to study a master's in journalism so I could specialize in covering changing demographics. So it's really my subspecialty in immigration in journalism coverage. We chose the topic of immigrant women and how they're affected because, as you know, Monterey County has a very large percentage of immigrant people. In 2011, the Public Policy Institute of California determined that about 62,000 undocumented immigrants live in Monterey and San Benito counties, which is 13.5% of the population. It's the largest proportion of undocumented immigrants in California. And that brings a set of challenges, of course. So tonight, to discuss those challenges, we have Bronwyn Moreno as the Director of Student Affairs and Special Programs at Hartnell College. I will mention who they are, and then I'll give a little bit more about them so they can then tell us a little bit more about their work they're doing on the ground. Adele Negro is a professor at the Middlebury Institute of International Studies in Monterey. Blanca, Zarazua is Honorary Consul for Mexico and an immigration attorney. And Elizabeth Zepeda is accredited by the Department of Justice, and she works for the United Farm Workers Foundation as a coordinator, outreach coordinator. Can we give them a round of applause? Bronwyn Moreno is responsible for implementing programs, services, and strategies to support educational equity for disproportionately impacted student groups. As the director of the Center for Achievement and Studies and Student Advancement, MICASA, she has led a campus-wide effort to support undocumented students at Hartnell. Bronwyn has designed support programs and worked with students in nonprofit K-12 and post-secondary settings. Her career is grounded in the belief that education is the basis for uplifting families and communities. And Bronwyn is going to tell us a little bit more about what she does in MICASA, the center.
Good evening. Well, thank you for the honor of being here tonight. And hello to my colleagues and some of our students. I am the Director of Student Affairs at Hartnell College, and I've worked at Hartnell for the past 5 years, but in 2015, the Hartnell College District made an intentional commitment to serving our undocumented students. We currently have 900 undocumented students at Hartnell College, which is about 7.5% of our student population overall. And we're very proud of that number. It continues to grow every year, which to us is a statement to the fact that students understand that if they come to Hartnell, they will be supported, that they will be safe. And so my personal goal here is to continue to communicate that message to students and to help provide the support that they need in order to succeed. And then also to collaborate with the many faculty, staff, and student leaders on campus who have already been doing this work prior to me getting this job. People have already been committed to supporting undocumented students. So sometimes it's just a matter of kind of lighting up all the dots and really creating a cohesive message of support that students can hear and increasing the visibility of the services and support that they receive. So that has been probably my proudest accomplishment, but just really the collaboration that we've had across all divisions and departments on campus.
Thank you.
The rest of your time.
Yeah. Thank you, Bronwyn. Now let me introduce to you Blanca Zarazua. Blanca maintains her own law practice in Monterey County and has been practicing since 1987. And she told me of Mike that she's thinking about doing something more adventurous, like parachuting or something. She began working as an associate tax counsel with Bank of America in San Francisco. She's now representing individuals and families with respect to immigration law matters and alternative dispute resolution. She's a member of the American Immigration Lawyers Association and serves on the board of the Latin American District Chapter, which serves Mexico, the Caribbean, and Central and South America. In 2003, Ms. Zarazua was appointed by Mexico's former president, Vicente Fox, to serve as Honorary Consul of Mexico for Monterey and Santa Cruz counties. And this is a perfect opportunity for me to ask you to please turn off your cell phones. Ms. Blanca Zarazua.
Thank you, Claudia. Buenas noches. Damas y caballeros. I try to not talk too much, but it's pretty futile. My father came to this country in 1945 as a bracero and landed in Chulat, that bustling metropolis just south of Salinas. And listening to your proudest accomplishments, I think my accomplishments are having been the daughter, still being the daughter of a Quirino Nandeña. And there's so much history that goes behind people, and we're not taking the time to learn that personal history. Everything's a tweet, everything's a post, everything is so superficial. And I'm here to promote conversation and depth and profoundness. I do want to get to know you. I want you to get to know me. And so my father came from Guanajuato, and he buddied up with the cook at the labor camp. He liked to eat a lot. And he was from Jalisco, and they started traveling to Jalisco together, and he ended up marrying the cook's daughter. And they lasted a mere 55 years, so it was a short flame. I have a tremendous amount of formal education, three graduate degrees. I've studied in England, I've studied in Italy, I've studied in Mexico. And I say it proudly, and I say it to inspire other people who come from migrant families who think that, you know, maybe studying in LA is quite an opportunity. It may be, but you should not limit yourself geographically or psychologically. And when I hear people say they're a dreamer as well, I think you need to dream big and never stop dreaming. My last semester in law school, I worked at the California Supreme Court, and then I worked at Bank of America as a tax lawyer. And so I practiced tax law for 20 years, and quite a technically demanding area of law. And then I thought it was just not speaking to my heart. And as I say, my heart speaks Spanish. My mind may speak English, but my heart speaks Spanish. And there was a disconnect between my mind and my heart, and I thought I need to do something that's more emotionally gratifying. And that's when I switched and started doing immigration work. I've been honorary consul since 2003. I'm the only honorary consul from Mexico and California. There are seven of us in the U.S. I've had some very, very good Mexican food outside of California. I just attended many events where there's just a whole different dimension to Mexican food and not what you typically see here. And with that comes a lot else. There's a whole different sub-language, psychology. There's so much that affects you and impacts you, and that's why I say to young people, stop contaminating yourself. Get out of that context. Get into a new context where you'll contaminate yourself in a different way that is more positive. I'm going to briefly talk about three cases that I've had as honorary consul, which means that I show up in court not as an attorney, but as a diplomat to assist the attorney who's been assigned to the case. You probably know about the King City class action case. I was one of the attorneys on that, where the officers were taking cars. I also had a recent victory, which I call my professional quinceañera, which was a DACA case where the fellow was just about to leave the Salinas jail, and ICE ended up detaining him. And the DACA card clearly says May 2018. And so, as I said, it was, you know, negligence at best and abuse of authority at worst. And so I just saw my client yesterday. He looks fabulous. He looked terrible before. I'm just so happy that he's recovering well. So very quickly, the three cases with the consulate that bring up the issue of women in this area are: one, the young gal in Greenfield who delivered a baby in a porta potty. I don't know if you remember that case. I'll never forget it. Second case where I appeared as a diplomat was Mr. Martinez, also in Greenfield, who transferred his daughter to a fellow, and there was a list, there was a contract, and so the guy reneged and he went to the cops to say this guy didn't abide by the contract. And then the last case was a lady from Guanajuato, from Pacific Grove, whose ex-husband was, she had 100 hearings in 1 year. Accusing her of kidnapping, et cetera, et cetera. And I will proudly say, after the second appearance that I made in court, all charges were dismissed. So I have a very unique way of looking at things because of my background. I grew up on the peninsula, but very, very traditional Mexican background. Like I say, our shampoo was Zest, okay? And we all, the sisters, we all took showers with our underclothes on. That's just what we did. We were very shy. So we were very legit, low-income gang people, and it gives me a tremendous perspective on things. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Blanca. Next, we have Elizabeth Zepeda. Elizabeth Zepeda is about to start law school. Yay, higher education. But she's already an accredited representative for the Department of Justice, by the Department of Justice for the United Farm Workers Union, Foundation. She has a BA in Social and Behavioral Studies from California State University, Monterey Bay. She has interned at the Watsonville Law Center and at the Santa Cruz Immigration Project, which means that she has already amassed quite a bit of experience. That was for Blanca, you beat your timer. She has amassed quite a bit of experience doing immigration work. Please.
Thank you, and thank you, Blanca, for allowing us to remind us of our roots, you know. I also come from an immigrant family. I was born in San Jose and raised in Hollister, a pretty humble family. I come from an immigrant family, and therefore my passion for helping others. I did a LULAC. I don't know if you folks know LULAC, and tonight I'm not representing, I have to say it, and I probably should take my pin off. I'm not representing the foundation or LULAC. I'm here as an individual. And growing up in a humble family gives you definitely a different perspective, and it shows you from very young that you have to advocate for those who can't advocate for themselves. That you have to step up for those people who don't know the language. Your parents' attorneys without a license, reading their paperwork, having information. And I just want to touch some things because we're talking about women tonight. Latina women have more responsibilities than Latino men. Many, many more responsibilities, from knowing how to cook, knowing how to clean, having your education, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I just want to say that I'm very proud to come from a humble family because it's pushing me to move forward. And I wish I were in the classroom full of students who are dreamers. I have many, many, many friends who are dreamers who are very successful now. And it's been very unfortunate that they you know, over the past year have gone through ups and downs. Is my status ever going to be removed? What is my situation? And I do want to mention that for everyone in this room, regardless of what you believe in, we have to stay united. We have to stay united and support our youth and our young adult. And regardless whether you're a female or a male, we all have responsibilities, and we all have a responsibility of doing something. Right now, racism is one of the most prevalent things that I've seen from my years in school, from which aren't as many as other folks, but I've seen racism increase significantly in classrooms. Even if you're asking for a burger at McDonald's, I've seen people say, well, I don't understand you. And clearly, I see that people speak that language. So we need to stand up for each other. We need to not forget where we're from. We need to continue and push. And we need to support our women who sometimes, you know, take upon more responsibilities than men. And I'm maybe not all women. But we need to stand up for our community overall. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Elizabeth. Our next speaker is Adele Negro. Adele Negro leads a multidisciplinary sustainable development practicum in El Salvador for the Middleburg Institute of International Studies at Monterey since 2006. She is a professional interpreter certified to practice in federal and state courts, in the United Nations, and in the U.S. Department of State. See, my glasses are not working anymore. She holds a Bachelor of Arts degree in French Language and Literature from the University of Michigan, a Certificate of Studies from Brian Mauer College in Avignon, France, and l'Institut de Sciences Politiques Paris, and a master's degree in conference interpretation and translation from the Middlebury Institute of International Studies at Monterey, where she taught for 6 years at the Graduate School of Translation, Interpretation, and Language Education.
Muchas gracias. Buenas noches a todos y todas. Gracias por acompañarnos aquí esta noche. Thank you for being here and being with us in this dialogue. I am very, very pleased to be here among the eminent women to my right. And I want to thank, in particular, Hartnell College, the Democratic Women of Monterey County, and more especially Ann Flower, a longtime friend and colleague of mine at the Institute, which is nicely represented here by more than one person, for this invitation to participate in this very, very crucial and important event. As Claudia said, as a professional interpreter and translator, it is, and trained at the Institute, it's kind of paradoxical and unusual that I am here speaking in my own voice for myself rather than transmitting the voice of others, which I do a lot in my professional life. And just in case, we won't get into the nitty-gritty of my profession, but when we say interpreter, it is the spoken word. When we say translator, it's the written word. I do both, and both require a set of skills which are required in training. And frankly, I got it from the then Monterey Institute for International Studies, now the Melbourne Institute. In being here tonight, I feel at one with this community in part because I, myself, am a daughter of immigrants, not from Latin America or from Spain, but from Italy. I grew up speaking Italian, and as an Italian speaker when I was very little, I was ostracized in school because I could not speak like everybody else. And so experience at the age of 5 years old, it really shaped the way in which I relate to the world around me. There are many other things that are shaping, but the understanding of ostracism because of my language, I think, has informed the way I go through the world. I don't consider myself an advocate per se. As a professional interpreter and translator, I can't serve as an advocate. I can do that in my personal life, but in my professional life, I consider myself a steward of language. I do not give voice to to those I interpret for. They have their own voices. But what I do is conserve and convey their voices. I serve as a conveyor of communication, as a bridger of meaning. As an interpreter, I spend my time, as Blanca so rightly said, listening deeply to people and attentively, and then transforming what I hear in the voice of others into the voice of the language that is my goal. And it goes both ways. This is a dialogue. You could say that our voices together, those I interpret for, and I, commit acts of border crossing linguistically. Of course, the old adage rings true, and it is a profound paradox in our profession as linguists. In Italian, the ancient saying is traduttore, traditore, translator, traitor. These border crossings of language inevitably betray the original voice, inevitably, because there is no exact equivalent. Nevertheless, and of course, at this time in our history, I am deeply concerned about the unreliability of language, the unaccountability of language by its users, to paraphrase the wonderful poet-farmer Wendell Berry. You have only to listen to the abomination that passes for language in the upper echelons of our government today to realize how important it is to steward and protect and preserve the voices that can give power, precision, expansiveness in the appropriate articulated language to the surrounding world that implicates us all. That is the environment in which I work. I sometimes feel, and I don't know if some of you can remember Fahrenheit 451, Ray Bradbury's dystopian, disturbing book, which I read at the age of 15, and I thought I'd probably have to jump off a bridge. That Fahrenheit 451, which is still all too relevant today, in which the book people, the exile drifters, memorized literature so that they could preserve it for the world. And that's what I think my role is, to preserve the voice of others for the world that surrounds us. We are here to speak about, in particular, immigrant women of Monterey County. Protecting and preserving their voices requires an understanding and a dwelling in their entire environment. We're talking about linguistic and cultural ecosystems. We're not talking only about individuals, but for every individual for whom I interpret or translate, there are many, many others attached to them whose environment must be taken into account, if not specifically, generally. And I think that in doing that, we have to remember that often men, women, and children are disaggregated from one another. Society disaggregates them. And especially I see that in the courts, in the prisons, even in the international setting, but I see it in the kind of context that brings us all together. There is an atomization of people. And what language, my profession, can do is reconnect the nucleus and the atom in a much greater cellular connection, which Blanca also referred to, which each of my colleagues refers to. There are grounding day-to-day experiences I have had as an interpreter, which we can get more into later, but there are six different anecdotes that I will only briefly mention. Two of them Blanca has mentioned already. Two of my most outstanding interpreting assignments were with Blanca, the woman who gave birth to a child in the porta-potty and was accused of murder, and the woman who was accused of stealing her child, of kidnapping, because of rights that she was not able to fully speak on behalf of herself to execute. And it was a very moving experience to serve with Blanca as the interpreter of these two women. I do justice only to their voices in the moment, but it's the listening, the ability to convey their sentiment that is part and parcel of my work. A few other anecdotes that I will briefly allude to, which have left a mark on me and which express the spectrum of the human condition for which linguists have to work and participate in or engage in, are Rufina Maya, the only survivor of the worst massacre of El Salvador in Mosote, the only survivor of 900, almost 1,000 people who were butchered in December of 1981, 3 months before she died in El Salvador of what I believe was a broken heart after seeing four of her family members butchered. I interpreted her story. It was the most difficult thing I've ever had to do. It was spellbinding and horrifying. This is the story of war, horror, silence, and heartbreak. And this story was brought to light by Ray Bonner and Alma Guillermo Pietro in 1982. I've already spoken about the mother who was raped and therefore had to deliver. I believe she was raped and therefore had to deliver this baby in the field. I have interpreted for many madmen whose wives are lost in the system. Recently interpreted for a complete lunatic. Heartbreaking in court, whose wife had no sense of where she would go. How do you convey to a woman who is totally distressed and isolated from others when she is living with a lunatic? These are the challenges of human isolation. I interpreted for the closure of the Jolly Green Giant plant in Watsonville in 1993 when Bill Clinton was about to sign NAFTA. This is interpreting for displacement, for the outsourcing of work, for the loss of dignified labor. I've interpreted for drug traffickers and gang members, in which I see what happens to broken, fragile, crime-implicated families, like the 21-year-old in federal court just now, whose baby is on the way, who is completely destitute and uncertain of what his life will be after 21. The whole idea of fracturing of families and the deportation of men, women, children. And finally, the last one that I will speak about is an international relations Interpol case in which I interpreted in San Jose for the robot dog bomb murder. A bomb was inserted into a robot dog to get vengeance for a jilted lover. I won't go into the details, but that's an entire short story unto itself. So you have the specific, the national, the international, the cross-border context in which all of us are implicated. And at some point later, I will talk about, if we have the time, the work I do in El Salvador, which brings together a lot of my work as a linguist, but a lot of my work in living in the world surrounding us in which we all take part.
Thank you so much, Adele. This is a pretty impressive list of cases you've been involved with. I would have to interview you afterwards. Now what I want to do is get a little bit into the theme of the panel tonight, the theme that is bringing us together, and it's the issue of women. And I think, from what I said in my work as a reporter, feel that immigration is affecting women differently than men. But I want to hear what your thoughts on that are. And so I'm going to give you some time to talk about that. How do you see education, law, community outreach, the courts? How is immigration and the atmosphere we live in right now affecting women differently?
So I have a unique perspective because the immigrant women that I get to work with and interact with every day are pursuing college education. And what I see amongst our students, the word that always comes to mind is these are warrior women. They are extremely tenacious, resilient, and creative. And just, we always like to point out that our Dreamer students outperform our non-Dreamer students at Hartnell College. They do not take their education for granted. They are here to honor their families, and their parents typically have sacrificed a great deal in order for them to achieve higher education, or they themselves have sacrificed and are currently sacrificing to be here at Hartnell. So it's really inspiring every day to see what they've endured, but also how they persevere despite some of the psychological trauma that we're all going through at the moment. I was speaking with a couple women in my office before heading down to the panel, and they said, this is what we do, we're used to this. They said, no matter what happens, we're going to find a way to succeed. And so, overall, the number of female students we have at Hartnell does exceed the male students. And then in our Dreamer population, we actually have 57% of our Dreamer students are women. And then the students who are actively involved in our program, 70% are women. So what we're actually seeing is the women are stepping up, and even though they're being challenged and stressed right now, they are exerting additional effort and they're continuing to persevere and succeed. That being said, I do think that women, we have a great burden as mothers, as kind of the nucleus of our families, but it has not stopped the women from achieving their dream. And that's what the trend that I'm seeing here at Hartnell.
Adele is almost like a souffle that's too tempting to avoid. I mean, I want to get a huge pot of coffee and just sit down and talk to you for maybe a couple of days. I think that...
you'd better make it wine.
Oh, I don't drink liquor, sorry. Anyway, I'm going to reduce and make it too esoteric, probably, the question. I think, to the extent that only women are mothers, I know that sounds very simplistic, but there's a physical commitment there of at least whatever it is, 6 months, 7 months, that you have to carry this child, whereas men, post-conception, there may be zero time.
There's no real
commitment there, necessarily. And I really, even as a kid, I used to hang out with boys, and they were my math buddies, and it was a very analytical, intellectual exchange. And I never really saw the physical differences in guys versus women. I've always thought of us as just brains that are in different packages. And so, what's your brain and what's your brain? And okay, so you've got this and I've got this, so what, you know? And going back to the thoughts that come to mind in terms of women versus men, I'm going to make it a little esoteric here, going off of Adele's comments. When I go to court, I always think of the Constitution and do we really have due process when we have indigenous folks? And you know the interpreter is terrible because there's no fluidity, there's interspersing of Spanish words, and you're like, okay, I know he came from Fresno, but he sucks. I mean, he's not a good interpreter. And this has tremendous ramifications if you take the Constitution at heart, that it still is worth something as a document and as a sign of democracy. Now, linguistics, going back to Adele's comment about translating and interpreting, there's so much more. There's cultural psychology. You need to know which question to ask. This is not like a precise UN interpretation. You need to understand that person, and I've been used for this for depositions and everything. The attorneys have their translators or interpreters. But you need to understand the psychology of the victim or the person there to understand how you're going to get a response that you need. Because certain responses are just taboo culturally. They're not going to say, yes, that guy did it, or yeah, he pulled the trigger, or he raped me. Forget it. And so you have to think of other ways, understanding the psychology about doing it. And I couldn't agree with you more in this society today, all over the world, I guess, because of technology, that words are being so disregarded. You know, in the name of efficiency, I just want to clean my screen, I just want to text back in 3 seconds. Well, you're not giving much dignity to yourself. You don't have a lot of self-respect when you don't choose your words carefully. And people aren't doing that anymore. And I think Adele's work, and I hope to some extent in my work, is to give back some dignity to the people who have been maybe socially violated, legally violated. You want to give some dignity by giving them a voice.
with precision and with emotion. I mean, there's such a thing as emotional precision, and there isn't enough of that right now, where you're really communicating those feelings in a precise way. And it goes way beyond language. It does. There's so much that I communicate without opening my mouth. And I know it's kind of useful sometimes. Sometimes, like I say, silence is powerful. You can just be connecting with the person without saying anything. And sorry, I know I'm getting off on a tangent, but the mom of the DACA student is such a warrior. She's such a warrior. When he got back, he was inappropriately detained by immigration, and then he finally got out. He went out and got it on bail, and he came to my office. I'd never met him because everything's video conferencing and blah, blah, blah. And then he came in, and he was so pale, and his head was between his legs the whole time. And that was about 3 months ago. He looked awful. He looked like those guys who come back from the war, and the mom's kind of happy, but they don't really have their son back. Because this isn't the son before they left for war. And that's what he looked like. So I saw him yesterday, and I said, oh my God, I finally got to see your teeth. I mean, there was a smile there. He just looked so much better. And I said, you know, irrespective of what's happened or what may happen in the future, you look fabulous, and congratulations. But it was mom and the women who were really persistent about being protectors, and not to get too instinctual, but if you have children, I mean, my mother was violent. You know, get out of there, who are you talking to? She doesn't want to dance with you anymore. Okay, she grabbed the guy off the dance floor, like, she doesn't want to dance with you anymore. Like, okay, that's great, PR mother, thank you. But I mean, just kind of that commitment of really protecting. And I know they say the men are the protectors. I think they may be historically protectors in other ways. But the women are the ones who just do not want any kind of harm to come to the children. And to feel so incapacitated, this mom, because she's undocumented, and she can only do so much. And I think it's a wonderful feeling for me, is what I'd like to share, that I can make that connection with the women who seem so unempowered, so insignificant.
Okay, before Elizabeth takes the microphone, I wanted to make a clarification. Blanca mentioned the court system and how sometimes interpretation is not done accurately. For those of you who don't know, there's a very sizable population in Monterey County of indigenous groups. Most of them come from the Mexican state of Oaxaca, where 17 languages are spoken. We have here in Monterey County speakers of at least Triqui, Chatino, Mixteco, Zapoteco, at the very least. We probably have more. Not too long ago, I saw a case in which they had to phone in an interpreter from Los Angeles because there was nobody here that could interpret his case. And it was very inappropriate because the judge was discussing his things that usually would discuss back in the judge's chambers. It was being discussed in front of the public because that was the only way in which this judge was able to communicate with this client, because the client did not understand Spanish. The only person who could understand him was this professor in Los Angeles. So that's what Blanca was talking about. And I have heard these interpreters, sometimes they're people with educational levels that are not very high, so their interpretation levels are not very accurate. Blanca says they sprinkle words in Spanish. I'm sure that that's probably, you know, like speaking English and you say taco, that's the word for taco. I'm sure that that's, in Triqui, the word for el camino, the road is el camino in Triqui and in Spanish. But I still think that there's probably a very high level of inaccuracy that happens, and that's a concern for the justice system, right? Elizabeth?
Thank you for that clarification. It's actually very true, and you see it every day. So I'm going to focus on the calls that I receive, and not only my office. There's several other offices, like Catholic Charities and other nonprofits that serve the migrant and immigrant community. I'm going to speak about the woman who call on the phone crying, saying, I need some form of help. My husband has been deported with my child. And those are moments what I see, not only do I pause and say, okay, well, let me deal with this now, and thankfully, I have the adrenaline to not break down, and you know, so on average, for the past couple of months, I've had 5 to 7 different cases where I had to find the resources for these families. Okay, you find the resources. You're mainly dealing with the mother. But in one case, when the mother has been deported and the children are there, sometimes the oldest sister is the one that takes the charge. And that's when you sometimes think, like, what is happening? I'm speaking about the women who not only fight for their children, sometimes they're, you know, single mothers, but when they have to face deportations, you really see that a huge need is there. A huge need for families to unite and, you know, the community to unite, but at the same time, you receive another call. And you say, there's something wrong here. It's not only the family is not being united. And then you receive another call saying, well, my brother was just deported. What do I do? He had DACA. He had X, Y, and Z. What do I do? Yes, I'm not an attorney, and we do collaborate with attorneys, and we try to find as many resources as we can for the families. But what do the mothers of those children who have been deported, or those women that are now deported, what happens to that their children now? And this is where we're going to bring, you know, more information regarding family plan. I know that Proyecto Plan Familiar from Santa Cruz is doing an amazing job. I know that mostly women in that committee are bringing information to families and how to fill out certain forms without having to give up, not necessarily custody. And so we need to advocate for those women who are in need, and not only women, but entire families. And that's my spiel.
Just going back very quickly to the indigenous interpreters, I want to speak up for them only because this is a tremendous challenge we face in California.
Thank you for doing that.
And the judicial system, because these are people who are part of a community that's trying to survive against all odds in a very hostile environment. And many of these interpreters require training. And it's no fault of their own that they can't quite interpret the way I can with the wonderful training I got at MIDS. But it doesn't require that to do a good job. We just need to have the adequate services. There are some wonderful professors at the Monterey, the Middlebury Institute, who are working on training programs for indigenous interpreters from the entire state of California and perhaps beyond. But I think it's very important to look at what that means and how do you understand a system in which, for example, and I have done a lot of interpreting that is called relay interpreting, where the indigenous interpreter only knows the indigenous language, let's say Zapoteco, Mixteco, Arico, Bajo, and then interprets it to Spanish, interprets that indigenous language to Spanish, I interpret from Spanish to English, then I interpret English to Spanish, and then the Spanish goes into the indigenous language. That's called relay interpreting. So we're getting more and more of that, and that is opening up the possibility for more training, or the consciousness that more training is needed. But it's a very, very difficult and a challenge, especially because some of the communities are more closed and more ensimismadas, so they're more inward-looking rather than outward-looking. The other thing I want to mention is the importance of interlocking services for the communities, the women, but all of the families in immigrant communities, the work that LULAC is doing, the work that LAC is doing, all the work that is being doing educational and health in legal services or an array of services are really much more needed. I work in the workers' I sometimes interpret in the workers' compensation system, injured workers, and in the courts too, a lot of civil cases where you see the, now I'm thinking in Spanish, the desamparados, those who are lacking in the support and the resources necessary to really insist on their rights in this system. And it's being aware of rights that is often lacking, and that the kind of work you're doing can help promote, because not only are you giving voice as an interpreter, but you are standing there in the presence of the need for more knowledge. And that is a conundrum that I, as the interpreter, cannot solve on my own. It's not always, it's very rarely appropriate that I give them the knowledge, but I can give them the sound through which they can express their questions or their needs. So these interlocking services that we need to provide to immigrant communities can help maybe stem the tide of some of this desperate helplessness that we're looking at, especially within the context of these tremendous deportations. And I have more to say on that, but we'll say that later. The deportation shows the desamparo, the helplessness and unprotected nature of communities.
I want to talk
2 minutes
more about me. I'll just give you 1 minute.
Microphone is not working.
Female psychologist.
Hello?
Yeah. You know, you see this feisty woman who I am, and I've been a lawyer for 30 years, and you think I've always been this snappy and, you know, not shy at all. I had to acquire a new psychology when I went to law school. I was raised very passively, shut up if you get the Diet Coke and say thank you very much. But I was very competitive, and I said, okay, I'm going to have to change. I'm going to have to start raising my hand instead of just hoping they don't call me. And so this is an acquired psychology that you see here. This is psychological processing in action. And so a lot of the problem still, because I see it, because I was there, is you can have all the program, the procedures, the knowledge. You don't have the cultural oomph. You have not been programmed to speak up. To speak up, even when 3 of your children have been killed, when your own children have been raped by your partner, when all of this, you just are not programmed. And I tell you that it's a latent little corner of my mind that is still that way, where I'm still too slow, because it's an acquired psychology, it's not a natural response. And I'm sitting here thinking, gosh, why did you not speak up? Because there's still residual in me. And you get a sense of how outspoken I am, but I've been processed, and there's people, women, who have not been processed. I have 2 women, the lady who had the baby in the porta potty, and recently another young lady whose partner abused children in the house. And she said, I said, did he abuse your children? She said, I don't know. I said, well, I think you need to do some research on that. You need to know, because those children may need help, and you may need help, and you all need help. She didn't look up to me during the whole conversation. I mean, the body language is so compelling. The whole time she was like this. It's a look of shame. I can see it 20 miles away. Before they even sit at my desk, I can see through my windows and I say, this woman is ashamed. And there's no really good reason for feeling the way it's been imposed. I talk about self-sabotage, where we let stuff come in and, oh, I don't go there, it's for rich people, I don't go there, it's for white people. And I'm like, why did you do this self-sabotage? I mean, don't take that crap in. You know, you're just closing opportunities for yourself. But a lot of people do sabotage from the outside, where they tell you, this is the way you're supposed to be, and don't speak up. And I've had so many people I'm trying to convince to bring a lawsuit against someone, and they just won't do it. And the damage is clear. But culturally, that's why when I do talks, I say, you're not going to fight, because fighting is not a positive cultural attribute. You're not, unless you're a boxer, but you're not supposed to fight. And so I say, you're not going to fight, I am. You're going to defend yourself, which is different. And then maybe it's a little culturally more acceptable. but it's just crazy, crazy, crazy. I'm still going through that process, and you see that I'm not shy. I'm taking up too much time.
I think that one of the things, do you want to talk about it?
Well, I wanted to just talk about my experience with kind of the cultural strengths that a lot of our students bring, because sometimes we hear, you know, our students aren't prepared, or we hear criticisms, like especially the stereotype of Latino families that, well, they, you know, they don't support their daughters going and getting a college education. So I just wanted to make sure that, you know, we honor the cultural, unique cultural strengths of our community. And what we see in our students and our professionals is that they may not have that kind of individualistic, aggressive cultural value, but they have a very, it's a value in supporting families, whole families, self-sacrifice, thinking of others, and the grit that I think comes from the cultural background that is unique of our community and immigrant families. So I actually have the opposite experience of working with my clients, because I have different clients than you. So I just wanted to make sure that we honor the cultural strengths of immigrant women as well.
Thank you for that, Bronwyn. One, it's interesting because I feel like I'm on a ping pong table. I hear Blanca talk and I go, yeah, when I was raised in Mexico, I was raised, born and raised in Mexico, was raised to be very obedient, never speak up, never, you know, contradict your elders. And I was very feisty. I did fight with my professors, with my teachers all the time. And I got in trouble a lot. So I can see Blanca's point. And I can see in the people that I interview sometimes that people, that women are very shy. But I can also see Bronwyn's point that, and I see that women, even though some of us were raised to be more subservient or more shy, some of us are like, there's this author that I adore. Her name is Elena Poniatowska. She is, she's a grand dame of letters in Mexico. And one time she came to the United States to do a touring, and the handler was, she likes to write her book and write her name and write a little message in the book and dedicate it to the person who's there. She talks to you and she's like, you know, she makes you feel like you're her best friend. And the handlers are like, okay, we have to go, we have to go. And at first she was like, but it's very impersonal, I don't want to do that, but it's getting late. And then she started going like, okay, that's fine. And then she does whatever she wants. And I start thinking of her as La Dulce Cabrona, the sweet, strong woman. And so that's how a lot of Latino women are, the Dulce Cabrona. They tell you, oh, yeah, no problem. Then they go do whatever they want. Because they don't have that in there, like the feistiness. They're going to fight you. But at the same time, they just aren't going to put up with that. They're just going to do whatever they want. So I can see both sides of the equation here. And I wanted to ask another question that I didn't, when I prepared this panel, I had to come up with a bunch of questions. And I'm gonna ask a question that I didn't ask you ladies. But I think it's important we address it, because I think we are right now amongst mostly people who would agree with us. But I also think right now we live at a time in our country that there's a lot of people, maybe not a lot of people, but there's some segment of the population who perhaps are very friendly to our cause tonight. Tonight we're talking very friendly about immigrant women and how maybe, what kind of support they need. But I'm sure there's not everybody who thinks that way. So I want to ask you, why should women, immigrant women, who are here perhaps with no papers, perhaps because not every immigrant woman is here illegally. I'm here, I'm an immigrant, and I'm here illegally. So perhaps, why should we support them? Why is this an important thing to do? And if I'm catching you throwing your guard and you need time, maybe you can ask another question and go to that later. And you want to talk about perhaps now something that I did ask you is the climate right now. The climate we have a very anti-immigrant climate. So. And Elizabeth wants to take it.
So first I'm going to address the climate by saying that you already know what the climate is and that I'm not going to expand on it. What I am going to expand on is why should immigrant women be supported? The Latino population by 2020 will be the largest minority majority. Women are creating businesses. Undocumented women are creating businesses. Undocumented women are bringing children to school. Their children are having a higher education. They're the future of this country. So if you're not already supporting immigrant women, I will give it a second thought.
Just start by saying that we are in traditional Ohlone land, and we need to remember that when we talk about, you know, documented and undocumented, that the borders are political constructs, and often when we're talking about immigrant women, we're talking about Native American women. So that, it's always, every time I hear the word like illegal, and I look at the human beings that that term is being used to refer to, it just, that concept to me goes out the window. So first and foremost, I think that, you know, we have to remember this is Native land and the history of our country. And then as my awesome colleague mentioned, our immigrant women are making huge contributions to our community. Some of, you know, our tax base, our local economy, state economy, federal economy, and then in terms of just the well-being of, you know, the types of services that we can provide, we need people who have the cultural capital and the ability to relate to clients, customers. They were driving the nation, really, and were the teachers, the lawyers, the doctors, the future of the economy. I think of, you know, one woman who takes services from our center, who is a single mom. She cleans houses at night, and she's studying computer science. And so, and she's brilliant, but she's worried about her future because is she going to be able to secure employment? She's sacrificing so much for her education now. So I feel a responsibility to support her because I want a kick-ass computer scientist who can help create a better world for me for tomorrow.
I think there's an undercurrent of racism in this country. People don't want to call it out, but when there's no other thing you can say about someone, and you know that's what it's about, then it's not said. And you say, wait a minute, this doesn't make sense. There must be something else. I mean, this person is qualified, this person is this, what's the deal? And of course, nobody's going to say, oh, he's black or she's Latina. And so what you do as a substitute is you criminalize the category. You say undocumented people, they're illegal, like they're triple homicide, okay? It's an international trespass, excuse me. And get in line, there's no line, you idiot. There's no line, people can't qualify. And so what you do is you repackage that strange person you've never really interacted with, and all you know is that they look different from you, and all you know is that they might be invading your neighborhood, and all you know is that the traditional criteria are pretty valid. I mean, hardworking people, filing taxes, this and that. And so you come to the conclusion that it must be some other thing that you can't put your finger on, which nobody will say. And sorry to get too political here, but I mean, you know, coincidentally, President Obama was and still is black. I know we're trying to avoid that little attribute, but it's huge. It's huge in terms of what was happening when he was president. It's huge in terms of what's happening now. You know, people can't get over that. Despite all of the other criteria and all of the requirements, he's met all the requirements, but he's not supposed to be smart, and he's not supposed to be busy because he's black. And so, without getting, you know, too activist here, because I consider myself an activist, but in a different way, I think that we really have to look at that and how that is used to divide us and separate us when we really should be working together.
and look for points of commonality, you know. And so labeling and criminalizing people by saying they're here illegally, well, you park for 30 minutes in a 20-minute parking zone too, you illegal. I mean, come on, is it commensurate with the blameworthiness that's being attached to people? Yeah, they've committed maybe an illegal act, but it's basically bureaucratic. It's basically that the law is not cut up with social reality. You know, the law's always behind. It's a civil rights movement. Oh, okay, maybe we need a civil rights act after how many people died and fought and all this stuff. So we're always behind legally, but it's that being behind that people use as a sword against people to make them feel like they're losers. Okay, you're a criminal, you're a loser, you haven't, you're not legal. Okay, and so it's just sort of a way to psychologically disempower and debilitate people. And I just think it's a travesty. I really do. How dare you? How dare you do that to our working families? I have so many families who come in and I say, these people have been working here for 30 years and this thing in Washington, D.C. gets to decide what happens to this family? Why? And so I think it's a time to recalibrate about what this country really means now and in the future. What is our value system? Do we really want to give that much weight and value to this versus that? I think that's the level of, I've always said way back that immigrants were going to import values that this country was losing. Bringing in values that were always American. What are those values? You know, we need to have a resurgence in old Americana values. And then it won't seem like we're all that different. Sorry, getting a little passionate here.
Before you give the microphone, I'd really like to, I would just like to make that point you and Bronwyn mentioned it, is that the families, immigrant Latino families, are very committed to family. And that's something that I don't see in other communities. I think that this country somehow values this idea that, you know, you get old, you get out of your house, and then you never see your parents again, or you just sit on Christmas and Thanksgiving, and then you grow apart, and then you don't like each other anymore. And that's, I think, part of the reason why this country is so much trouble. You have families in the Midwest who have kids in the East Coast or the West Coast, and they don't like one another, and that's just so sad. And so, and with our Latino families, you know, you go to the Christmas party and you live in the same community and you are, you know, very close to one another. And that's one value that is being brought back. And that is, I consider it very, very needed, because we need a lot of support. We, this country, the mythology of this country, and this country we discovered was founded with a lot of mythology, is that everybody's on their own, you build yourself by the bootstraps, and you're just, you can be top John Wayne and go to the Wild West and, you know, herd cattle and be a macho man and you'd be great, right? Well, that's not how it works. You need a lot of support. You need people who will help you. You will need your parents to take care of your children when you go to work. And if you cannot afford that, then how are you gonna do it? And that's what Latino families are doing. They are bringing back those values that seem to have been lost and that are being recovered. And I, of course, personally think that's great. I'm sure that there's other people who disagree, but hey, that's just the way we are. Adele.
Well, going back to your question about why should we support immigrant women or immigrants in general, because again, I insist on not separating out women from their context. And looking at what the evening tonight was billed as, which is looking at the economic and social marginalization of women when many of their men are being deported, and what does that imply? I'd like to compare women, no matter whose country they belong to, what borders they cross, to trees. Trees anchor the environment, they anchor the soil, they keep the erosion from occurring. They prevent flooding in devastated areas that are devoid of trees. The great Wangari Maathai, who won the Nobel Peace Prize for her work in planting trees in Africa, was a symbol of this idea of rooting people in their place. And the place is our surroundings. And I think the short-sightedness, the abysmal short-sightedness in this country of what immigrants can do to root their families their people in place and acquire the dignity that makes them world inhabitants rather than inhabitants of Kansas City, where we should all be white and speak English. I don't want to demean Kansas City. I have very good friends there. But I think the question of place and the borders that, and the limits that are put around place destroy the concept of trees, the concept of nature and how it roots in place what must flourish and survive. And I think women immigrants should be supported with that in mind. Now, we're a long way from that, but I think the concept of why we should support immigrant women who are undocumented is because they root in place family objectives, hopes, dreams, and they make everyone better. We are marginalizing more and more, and people will find their family, they will find their community, they will find their gang, they will find La Mara, they will find the MS-13 when there is no more amparo, when there is no more protection, when there's no more family, because the father was a drug trafficker and he's 10 years in a federal prison, and he's back in Mexico, or the kids that came here during the Civil War in El Salvador who were 5, 6, sent across the border so they wouldn't be killed by the military or by the guerrillas. They're sent here, they grow up in East LA, they have no connection with El Salvador, and then they're deported when you consider them dangerous to the public. And they are desamparados twice, once here and then back again in their supposed country. Rather than looking at the concept of trees rooting us all into a place where we can all be part of an ecosystem, I am very firmly believing in the question of ecosystems and not individuals who have merit unto themselves. But we are merit in the community in which we nourish and nurture. And this is what is the desperate nature of the work we all do, that we are looking at the disintegration of community rather than the aggregation and cumulative effect of seeding the soil with each other. And immigrant women do a lot of that. My grandmother did that. My grandfather, who believed in the Marxist revolution, came over here and was a cabinet maker and a butcher, and he didn't speak English, but man, did he know his bakunin, and did he know the dreams that people had when they were destitute. And he made a life for himself, as your father did, as all of our people do. They made a life for themselves because there was a community that, well, like Ethel Lazarus says on the bottom of the Statue of Liberty, that is supposedly to be thrown over because it said, give me your tired, your poor, your hungry masses, yearning to breathe free. And these are the dictums and the hopes and dreams that we are willing to wash away because we don't see it as a retainer of water and a retainer of oxygen and a retainer of nitrate instead of pushing it out and eroding the soil of our human communities. That is the tragedy of the commons, the erosion of the community in which we take no part because you are not like me, because you are not my color, because you don't have blue eyes, you know? This is the tragedy of the commons, and it's that can be rectified by having immigrant women part of us.
Thank you for that. You want to speak again, Blanca. 1 minute.
Sorry,
just laughing, I'm used to it.
I'm just laughing you, 1 minute.
Yeah. I want to get to a concept that you just thought about with respect to my mother, is an immigrant woman still. That when my father died, we went out to a social event for the first time since he had died, and she brought it up. She said, Blanca, this is the first time I'm going out without your father. And it got me to thinking that in certain time periods, and even now, women got a certain sense of dignity by going out with their husband, okay? There was a layer of dignity. And so no matter what you were, you had a man at your side, and that had some value. I know it sounds very retro, I'm just telling you what the deal is. And so, what is immigration doing? Maybe the mom and dad aren't married, and maybe they had a certain dignity because there was a guy in the house, for whatever reason.
And through deportation, you're even taking that away from me, that dignity of knowing that there's somebody protecting me in my house. And you have shown up and taken him away in front of my children. And so talk about really trying to get at your core and make you weak because of that devastation. I mean, I don't think we really think about it, but it's all this stuff that we might think is kind of weird, I know, because I'm very old school. I think there's certain dignity to having a guy in the house. We don't have one, so I don't know. But it just goes back to having that element. It's almost like back in the day, if you didn't have children, it's almost like you had nobody to help out at the ranch, and you know, there was an element that was missing. Now, if you don't have a cell phone, you feel like crud, whatever. I mean, there are elements to society that are missing through institutions, through deportation. I mean, they're taking away the one thing you had. Maybe you never got married, maybe you couldn't get married, whatever. The woman is there without the guy, and I think we need to think about that.
I think it's important, and well, so the panel was called Immigrant Women and Immigrant because I do believe also that to a certain extent women are affected differently. This is not, I believe it's important to keep the women in their environment, and not just women, but everything. We have a tendency in this country to separate things. I call it, in Mexico, the people plant corn, squash, and beans together. It's the milpa, right? Because they nurture each other. And I love that. I think that's a really good thing. When you have things that are intermixed, they really give you strength. And in this country, we only plant corn. And God forbid there's a little bit of herb there, because then we go with the fume again. We don't like the herb, you know, the herbs there. Well, I think that's really unhealthy for the land. And so I think what's healthy for the land is to be intermixed. Women should be part of their environment. However, they do get affected differently. I mean, that's, there's just no question. And that's just my humble opinion. The last question I'm going to ask you is, it's about, we have had a couple of government programs, for instance, DACA, Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals, that have helped immigrants to a certain extent, and also sanctuary policies. Salinas City, in its infinite wisdom, declared this a welcoming city, not a sanctuary city, because there's been a lot of controversy about that. I wonder what your thoughts on that. Are these helping? Are they not helping? What do you ladies think? DACA and sanctuary cities, do they help? Do they not help?
We have a lot of our students here have our DACA recipients. And
let me just say, DACA is a program that helped legalize children who were brought to the United States illegally when they were minors. And that's been, it gives them a couple years relief, so they don't have, they won't be deported. That program may be in jeopardy right now.
So DACA is an executive order, it's not legislation, so that's a lot of the anxiety and stress following the election was specific to the fear that DACA was going to be rescinded, especially amongst our students who are employed, because they have a temporary social security number related to their DACA permit. So it has, I see the benefit just because it does allow students to seek employment and then also pay taxes, and then also a sense of protection, temporary driver's license. We even have two students who were able to travel abroad because they applied for advanced parole, and they visited Spain through our Bronda Scholars Program, and it was a life-changing experience for them. So it allowed them to live with some level of normalcy. And these are kids who grew up here, so if you were to meet them today, you would never know anything about their status. These are, you know, regular American kids that wanted to go on a travel abroad program. So they were able to do that. And the downside to DACA is just the constant anxiety that is it going to be taken away, and then the need to renew. You have to go through kind of an expensive process every 2 years to reapply. So it's definitely not a sustainable solution. However, it has had great benefit. And then a lot of folks who are relying on DACA, you know, for future employment now are, we're looking at alternative strategies. So individual taxpayer ID numbers, independent contractors, things like that. So we're already coming up with our contingency plan. In regards to sanctuary policies, I know the word sanctuary is controversial because on the pro-immigrant side, the word sanctuary can be misleading because although you can have practices and policies in place to try to limit cooperation with ICE, you can't actually prevent ICE from coming in if they have a judicial warrant or subpoena. Sitting next to a lawyer here, but so you don't want to mislead and provide like a false sense of security. However, you can create policies and processes under existing law to protect people's privacy. And so at Hartnell College, we have a board resolution in support of undocumented students and affirming the privacy of student records. And it's a written public statement, and it's all based on current federal law, which basically says that we're not going to use our school resources to support any kind of cooperation with ICE, and we're not required to do that. And then in addition, we have an administrative policy and a board policy that tells us exactly how to protect privacy of records. And then we always have to follow the Family Educational Rights and Privacy Act, which prevents us from disclosing students' immigration status. So the thing is that students don't always know about those policies. So for us, kind of our version of a sanctuary policy is to make that information public because we need to make sure that students understand what their rights are and that they feel confident in coming here that their information is going to be protected.
10 seconds, I promise. So hot off the press, I have kind of a literary bakery in my computer. I get stuff, you know, hot bread coming out of the oven. So at 5:37 this evening, there was a, it's all rumors. You never know with the president if he's gonna stay on point for 3 seconds or more. It says that the president is, quote, seriously considering ending DACA. What does that mean? I don't know. But it does say that ending DACA would contribute to a loss of $460.3 billion from GDP over the next 10 years and the removal of 685,000 workers from the economy. So if you're into math and statistics, that's pretty daunting figures.
Excuse me?
That's can you just let the speakers? Can you please keep quiet? Thank you.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you for your free speech.
Is that it?
That's it for me.
Yeah. Thank you, Wendy.
So I'm going to stay focused with DACA. DACA, and I'm just going to mention that a lot of our students are college educated, and they go through a whole hurdle of renewing their permits, making sure they're on time, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Because if you don't have that work permit and your employer finds that, looks at it, and follows protocol as they should be doing, you're gonna be unemployed. You're gonna be unemployed. So how are you, my question to you folks, and you don't have to answer, how are you allowing people to support themselves by taking, you know, some of the basic rights to work and to feed themselves the proper way? And I just want to leave you with that thought.
Okay, we're going to be taking questions from the audience. I'm going to ask you to be very respectful. This is a very challenging topic for everybody. We all have our opinions, but if you can express them really briefly, just one sentence, very, very respectfully. Should we, I guess we, I can bring you the mic.
The mic is right here.
Oh, there's the mic here. Yeah, come up here and ask your question.
Not an opinion, just a question. Is the women's movement and all the organizations and activities in those directions in any way participating or contributing to the support for immigrant women? Is there any connection or any work that works that way?
I don't know who wants to answer. Anybody? I want to start answering the question by doing a little plug for Marcy. Where did you go? There's an organization, local organization that has been getting together. It's called the Salinas Valley Rapid Response Network, and it's been trying to organize to bring service to immigrant women, especially when there's moments of crisis, like if they're partners get deported or something happens. That's a way that this network is bringing together other organizations, is bringing together the United Farm Workers, the United Farm Workers Foundation, the unions. So if something happens, people respond quickly, and also we can bring services. There was already a training for rapid response. And there will also be some trainings for people to learn how to accompany the people that need the services. The deportation centers are not in the area. The people who get apprehended, they get sent to Yuba City. Blanca knows more about that. She can probably tell you more about that, and I'm sure she will. But there's this network getting together, trying to bring those organizations together. If you want more information, there's a table there for you to sign up, and there's also cards that we're distributing to people so they can ask for resources if they need them. So that's one of the only ones, the only organizations that I know. I know there's also local organizations that help women, not necessarily because they're immigrants, but because they're working in the fields and they happen to be immigrants. For instance, the Líderes Campesinas is a group that helps women who work in the fields, who happen to be most of them immigrants. So they're not being helped because they are immigrants, they're being helped because they're workers. And that happens to be the case in a lot of instances that's the case. They receive services not because they're immigrants, but because they happen to be live in this community and need the services because they're community members.
Just a sidebar on what would I do without you? Flicking
a switch, I need you. On the rapid responders, it's really important that people document how ICE approaches would be deportees and detainees, because technically, under the law, if there's evidence that's gathered in an inappropriate way, we as attorneys can do motions to suppress with the court. And if we can exclude evidence that the government is using to make its case that this person is a foreign national, and none of that is able to be presented in court, then we can get the whole deportation thrown out. So it's important, it's an important function to really document what was done. Did they kick the door down? Did they show the warrant? Whatever.
And the rapid response team is supposed to be training people to do that kind of stuff, that kind of documentation. It's been a challenge, but we have Marcy here from Rapid Response. Maybe she can talk about it a little bit more.
Yeah, we have Know Your Rights training, we have Rapid Response training, and the third wing of our training will be accompaniment training. This is for post-detained people, helping the family, finding out where the detainee is, etc. And that will be new. No one's done that in this area yet, but that's the way the whole nation is moving in protecting immigrants throughout the nation. We have red cards that we distribute, Know Your Rights, and this is a number to call if you suspect you see ICE. And I'll be glad to give these out to anybody because it's staggering. And there's also a sign-up sheet if you're interested in getting involved in Salinas Valley Rapid Response. We meet every other Tuesday at the United Farm Workers meeting hall on East Alisa. But if you sign up, we'll send you an email and let you know we need people. We have lots of things we want to do, including putting on plays, role-playing, going into the field, getting as close as we can to educate people about what's going on and making people feel more safe and secure. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Here we go. Can all of you hear me okay? Three of you
1 minute, 56 seconds.
I can't begin to comment on all the mistakes and everything.
Sir, it's just a question that we're asking to propose tonight. Just a
pardon? There is in personality things, measurements of feeling versus judgment. People who have feelings that feel compassion for the needy, as I have. I think that the undocumented woman that Veronica and her two children were about 4 years old and trying to survive and everything. I don't think Donald Trump could say hello because they don't do her. That the you are driven beyond all human reason by the need and the desperation of these people. It is huge. Or you see the clothing of the people who have come here and think how the human beings endure this time.
And so what's your question, sir?
Pardon?
What was your question?
I'm commenting on all of these things. You are all in the feeling category. You're not in the judgmental category. If you do a little research, here's the research to do.
Sir, we're going to have to wrap up soon, and I don't mean to interrupt.
Then this is a one-sided discussion,
no, it's just a question,
and we have not really addressed the whole judgment in the things.
So we're just asking
if you
questions.
Are dumb enough to not realize that a green card for an immigrant means a pink slip for an American worker, you are dumb enough to vote for the Democratic Party.
All right, sir. Okay.
That's terribly insulting, Bill. You got
to
go.
No, you are stupid enough to think that a wall is going to stop immigration. This is the truth.
All right, thank you for coming.
I'm not going to put up with a one-sided, lopsided.
You don't have to.
You don't have to hear.
Thank you.
You help to pay attention to the facts. If you think that this community is a better place today, I'll pay you. You know, put up your.
Mr. Morales, you should be nice to voice his opinions that are very not based on facts, which is very unfortunate. If you go to the fields and you can go any day, you can speak with any agricultural owner, and they will tell you that they want to hire U.S. people, want a raise, and they are never going to work. And this is a fact, it's documented fact. And so, yes, right
don't
now
talk
they pay $50 an hour, and they still not coming.
Maybe
I'm going to have another question.
My question will be a little bit off the point, but migration studies is an expertise area that I've spent my life on, and one of the issues that strikes me from the comments that you've made that I think is important that needs to really be stressed, and that is that the problem, as it's seen, from people who are voicing opposition to immigration and so forth, it's stemming and located in the issue that we never talk about, which is social class and inequality. And the migration movements that are happening are poor people in one country coming to another country in which they're maintaining the same status. And women are a big, large part of that movement of poverty. And so, as you try, I think, courageously to help people who are moving across these borders, but still carry the same inequalities from the societies they come from to this country, the inequality persists, and it worsens with both ethnicity and color. And if you want to look at immigrants who come and had a really sort of free ride, in a sense, as you can look at the Cubans that came into Honorary under any kind of set of circumstances that were provided to them. And so, and the class differential, who were they moved, the women in the classes, they don't face the same issues that women in this immigration period now, and probably historically have faced. And so, you know, as you work with them, it seems to me that, you know, some of the national movement that unites women within inequalities that they are setting in their societies and come into here is long overdue. Is that we really begin to unite under the common area of social class, which no one talks about. Thanks.
Thank you. Does anybody want to comment on that? Like I said before, immigration is a very tough topic for a lot of people. I think that it brings the primordial to some of us. So, if you have another question, anybody?
This is a question.
Okay, ask your question. Can you ask your question?
Yes. First, my name is Dover Renders, and this question is probably for Bronwyn.
Yes, sir.
You will probably know the answer the best, but some of you others may as well. What percent of Latinos under the age of 19 in Salinas have had at least one child?
How's that relevant? I don't understand why you're even asking.
I don't know the answer, but
I think
53%.
Is it a crime to have a child?
Huh?
Is it a crime to have a child?
The ones that have no father, it is.
Why? Well, they have a father because he was not by the Virgin Mary, right?
Their father is.
How do you know if their father is not?
60%.
I think we need to have a question.
Yeah,
so I think
we're going
to.
Jesse,
you want to ask
a
question?
I'm Jesse, I'm a longtime resident of Salinas. There was a question asked about activities to support women, immigrant women, you know, about their rights. There is a conference held once a year. Called the Acomi Conference. You know, the Latin Orgullo Mujer Inmigrante, it's women, immigrant women advancing with pride. That focuses on the health in all iterations of a woman's life, because the central premise is that the individual's health affects everybody else. And if a person is strong and advanced, has access to a variety of things, then the entire community is better. Some of what you just saw and some of what you just felt was exactly what the opposition wants to do. This particular speaker, and everybody has a right to their opinion, this particular speaker agitates this way. And he promotes this interaction, this internal stress that you feel. Everybody got excited, voices went up, people stood up, surrounded, all kinds of things. That's their point, to disrupt, to move us away from what we are trying to do and the discussion we're trying to have, and talk to each other respectfully and openly about difficult things. So I'm glad that this group has moved on. I just wanted to make that comment.
Thank you for bringing us back. We need to, if we don't have any more questions, we need to wrap up, and maybe we will wrap up with a quick comment by each one of our presenters. If you feel like it, and if not, then I'll give the microphone to Regina because she's going to scold me. 10 seconds. Okay, 1 minute. In Blanca, 50 seconds, 49 seconds.
Just a closing remark?
Just something that we would like for the audience to leave with here, and just put it beautifully, but if you want to say anything more beautiful, that would be great.
I think more than ever, now is a time to pause, to reflect, and to treat others with respect. I think allowing oneself to be provoked is one of the strongest signs of weakness. Don't let yourself be provoked. Like I say, call me when you recover. And we have many recreational instigators all over the county. It's predictable. Don't get upset. Relax. The mind is in charge and we're very smart.
Thank you, Doug.
I would just close. I definitely have my college educator hat on tonight, in case you guys haven't noticed, but I would just close by saying we're very fortunate to live in the state of California, that students who have been able to acquire a high school diploma are treated as California residents for tuition purposes when they come to Hartnell College. So the exception to that is for adults who arrived after the age of 18 and weren't able to attend high school. There's still barriers there in terms of accessing higher education. So we are, you know, still advocating and trying to change our local policies to make college affordable for those students. But that being said, we do have a Dreamers Fund in the Hartnell College Foundation. It's a really simple way if you want to directly support undocumented people in our community. You can help contribute, and we have emergency scholarships. We collaborated with United Farm Worker Foundation to provide a DACA renewal fees for students who are trying to renew their DACA before the laws change. We appreciate your support. We thank you for coming out tonight for this dialogue, and it's good to be here.
Know your rights, know your constitutional rights, review your constitutional rights, and don't just stand there or sit there without doing any. Well, sometimes it's better, like today. But know your rights so that you can defend the rights of others.
I would like to say, and I don't want to, you know, open up a whole geopolitical theme at the very end, but I do want to say that war and the wars that we have supported throughout the decades and the centuries have created many of the immigration or the immigrant communities in our country today, including some of the people in this very room, dear friends of mine, who have had to flee from their native lands because of civil strife and brutality in their countries, and they've made a home here and elsewhere in a very dignified and productive way. We're all immigrants in most cases. My work in El Salvador is a way for me now, and thanks to the Institute that gave me the opportunity to direct a sustainable development program in El Salvador, I have looked at what it means to speak up and be engaged in the voices for the earth and sustainable community, voices that are integrative, inclusive, collaborative, and vibrant. And it's what I see in what is happening in El Salvador and what we are trying to do in many different communities of the world is restoring the balance that we have so devastatingly wrecked through war and forced migration, whether it's through war or through economic devastation, through environmental devastation. So I think we have to look with hope at the models that are being developed in the world around us, whether it's in Salinas or in El Salvador or in Africa or in Asia, where people are trying to restore the balance of the earth with voices raised on behalf of human and natural survival.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you everybody for being here. The last thing I want to say to you is that we are in this room very privileged people, all of us. And so share a little bit of your privilege with the less fortunate. I know you do already, but if you have a little bit more to give, sign up for a rapid response and you can accompany people. And thank you very much to the Democratic Women of Monterey County for inviting us. It's been great. I really appreciate it, Regina, Anna. And thank you so much.
I don't know if I
Thank you again for coming out on Thursday night. I personally think it's very important to hear other perspectives. I think that's one of the issues. However, would it be great had that person ask the question, because I do think it's important to hear what other people are thinking, but it's hard to hear what they're thinking when they just want to kind of stand up and
agitate, disrupt.
We can't really have a conversation. But I encourage you to go out and talk to people with different perspectives. And again, thank you all for coming out. Thank you again. We left some information cards if you want to know what we're up to. Check out our website. Come to our fundraiser. Come to a luncheon. Be well. Have a good time. Thank you.